Hello, my lovely anatomists and physiologists. Let's finish up with a conversation about what is described as absorptive state versus post-absorptive state. Essentially, absorptive state is when you're eating food and absorbing nutrients. And remember, it's taking, you know, in some cases about 4 hours to absorb a single meal. And of course, that's dependent on the quantity and type of nutrition that you've eaten. And so for most of us with access to food, we're going to be in the absorptive state when we're awake and when we're active. So for a lot of us, we're able to eat breakfast and then maybe a snack. Okay, let me just say, this is how I eat food. This is how I eat food. So I like to have a breakfast, and then I like to have a snack, and then I have lunch. And depending on my lunch, I may be able to make it to dinner. I may have a snack before dinner, maybe a little bit of a snack after dinner. So essentially during the waking hours, about that 12-hour period of time, I'm either actually putting food in my mouth or I'm holding that food in my stomach and 3 milliliters at a time, squeezing it into my small intestine and absorbing those nutrients. That's absorptive state. Of course, if you're fasting, if you don't have food available, if food is scarce, then that's going to be a little bit different in that particular case. During the absorptive state, we see the hormone insulin, which remember is being released by the beta cells of our pancreas, being released. And so we're seeing at this time, we have a high level of glucose uptake by our cells. We see that we are packing away our lipid in the molecule triglyceride. So we have a lot of triglyceride synthesis. We see during this time that we have a lot of protein synthesis. So when our glucose level is high and we have a lot of available glucose, we're going to use it for metabolism and we're going to store our triglyceride or store our lipid as a triglyceride, and we're going to go ahead and make our proteins because we have the energy that we need and we don't have to break down those amino acids as a backup reserve. We'll also see in this case that when we're releasing insulin, our growth hormone is going to help us increase our amino acid uptake by our tissues, which makes sense since we're doing an increase of our protein synthesis. So essentially in the absorptive state, when we have all of our ingredients available to our body, then our body is gonna go through the process of doing a lot of metabolism and making the molecules that our cells need. Okay, that should make sense. The post-absorptive state is when you're limited to your internal reserves. So you're not taking on any additional food, you're not eating, and you don't have food held in your stomach that you're absorbing. So you've run out, you've used up whatever was in your stomach. So for me personally, this is usually, you know, when I'm asleep. That's when I'm not eating. For other people, this might be happening because of a choice, because of fasting, or this may not be a choice if there's not available food, right? And so the big thing that's happening in the post-absorptive state is you're going to do what's called glucose sparing activities. So glucose sparing is talking about we need that glucose for red blood cells and for our neurons. We need glucose for red blood cells and for our neurons. Every other cell needs to use something else. So other cells are going to switch to using their lipids to make ATP. Or if we run out of lipids, then we're going to start breaking down protein to make ATP. And we see post-absorptive state is going to be under the control of the hormone glucagon, which is like the antagonistic hormone to insulin or the opposite hormone. This one is released by the alpha cells of the pancreas. This one is going to do reverse type of activity. So we're going to break down our triglycerides. So that we can release those fatty acids to make ATP. We're going to increase our glycogen breakdown. Glycogen is the way that our skeletal muscle is able to store glucose. So we're basically here dipping into our fatty acid reserves and our glucose reserves. We're going to also see that the liver can make glucose. So we're going to increase our gluconeogenesis. That's happening at the liver. And we'll also increase our protein breakdown. Because again, we can also use amino acids to make energy if we have to. So when we're in the post-absorptive state, we're accessing our reserves that we've packed away in the body during the absorptive state. We'll also see in this post-absorptive state that this is under the control of epinephrine, glucocorticoids. Growth hormone here is going to trigger also glucose sparing activity. So growth hormone could do different things depending on if it's in the presence of the insulin or the glucagon. If we go back and think about the absorptive state, we do want to look at how carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids are digested and how they're absorbed. So we do need to know how carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids are digested, meaning are they digested in the mouth, in the stomach, in the small intestine? What are the enzymes that are involved in the digestion? And then how do we actually get those nutrients, those ingredients absorbed into the bloodstream during the absorptive state? And rather than just giving out those notes in a video for you to write down, I'm going to provide those notes in the video description. So I'm going to have a page of notes for you to look at. It's going to map out what's going on with each of these macromolecules, and it's focusing in on how they are digested and then how they're absorbed. So check out print off if you'd like that, and include that in your notebooks. And that completes our videos for digestive system. So as always, take care of yourselves and each other.